Hi, I'm Alexander Shelley. I'm the Music Director of Canada's National Arts Centre Orchestra. Conducting is my life and my passion and my joy. And I'm here today to look at some excerpts from movies and from TV of actors conducting to just give my perspective on how they're doing, any critique I might have, any praise I might have. And I'll have to start with that, to be honest, because anybody who tries on camera to conduct is already doing really well, because it's a strange and weird and kind of mysterious profession for most people. And as a conductor, I know as well as anyone that there are many, many different ways to do it. But there are certain things that I look out for that are authentic or not, because an orchestra will respond to certain gestures, to certain movements, to certain impulses, and to others they won't. But let's dive into these videos and see what is happening specifically. Okay, here we go.
Symphony Orchestra.
Okay, so this is Mozart in the Jungle with the New York Symphony Orchestra and Rodrigo, and they've gone out into the city to kind of break down the ideas of the idea of the ivory tower. Okay. So I'm going to pause for a second here. Oh. So firstly, I love the idea. There's a lot of orchestras and ensembles around the world are doing this. Get out into the streets to play in unusual spaces. I think it's something that's become very popular over the last few years. I'd also say that our protagonist here is doing a lovely job in his body language of setting the mood of the music. Because if you're listening to something that's as calm as that, you know, if I was just having a conversation with you, you'd want me to keep my body language calm and still. If I'm trying to be calm and still, if I'm doing this while I'm trying to be calm, it's not going to work. It's a common misconception about orchestras is that a conductor indicates where people have to play. It's really not as simple as that. This is also a section of music which is slow, and there's only a small group of musicians playing. As a general rule, you can give them more space to simply play, to lead one another. They don't need you to be dictating the timing. So from that perspective also, Rodrigo, I think, has the right approach here, that he's letting them play. The other thing I noticed just before I pressed pause was that they did a little cut across to Hailai, who's listening intently to the beautiful music. But they made a little error in the edit, because you see a couple of musicians playing away, and if you look at the tip of one of the bows moving, it's moving away very fast. So obviously they caught that little bit of the scene from another moment when they were playing a different piece of music, and they, in the editing, just said, ah, you know, whatever, no one's going to notice. I noticed. So let's watch a little bit more. Okay, I have to stop here. I'm sorry. She is a superb actress, and I love the fact that she is doing it. She's actually playing the cello, but the vibrato is all over the place. She's like this. The largest kind of vibrato you're going to see from a cello player is around here. Also, her ball holders kind of. But that's something, for example, that a professional musician that jumps out at how she's actually playing the instrument. Okay. That's not bad. Okay, so there's a few things in that that scene that were good and a few things that were not great. They've obviously peppered in the orchestra that he's working with, they've peppered in some professional musicians, or at least musicians who play their instruments seriously. So you see in certain moments of the music that people are absolutely in the right part of the bow, making the right gestures. You see in other edits that they're not quite playing the right thing. There are moments where the character Rodrigo is conducting the way he should do. So for example, the final bam, the way he gives the downbeat there, that would have kind of worked. And the cutoff, by the cutoff I mean stopping the musicians from playing, it would have worked too. But before that, they cut to a few gestures that had really nothing to do with the music. So I'd say that it was a very good attempt and very well-meaning attempt, but at like closer inspection, there were just a few moments in there that were not quite accurate. I love so much about this show, and I remember when I first watched it, having been skeptical before the fact I just couldn't stop watching it. I thought it was a really great show, and any show that features music like that and features the inside workings of an orchestra is a big thumbs up for me. So let's go on to the next excerpt. Aha, this is Tar. I recognize that already. Okay. So, first big comment. I recognize this orchestra. This is the Dresden Philharmonic Orchestra. And so this is a professional orchestra playing this piece authentically. So they're really playing what we're hearing, which means that every gesture, every movement of the musicians is exactly right because they're actually playing it. It means that Cate Blanchett had the extra pressure, if you will, of standing in front of an excellent professional orchestra and having to figure out how to genuinely conduct in a way that, at the very least, is not going to bother them so that they can keep playing. When musicians look at their music, they'll see a line of notes and they'll see an indication as to, for example, how loud to play that. Sometimes they'll see words in different languages that talk about how to play it. So it might say, softly with expression, softly but agitated, softly but tranquil. So one of the roles of a conductor is to define that either through word, but normally primarily through gesture. If I go like that with a little smile and a kind of invitation, it might be that we're going to a game. If I go like that and show a little bit of a frown, it's like, oh my God, you just had an argument with your partner. Two different kinds of agitated, two kinds of soft. You'll have noticed both of those gestures I gave were small. Let's say it says loud and agitated. I might go, that's the smiley, we're going to the game, loudly, or like that bigger gesture, but something that's negative, okay? So augmenting the gesture means the orchestra knows what the music is. This happens to be Mahler's Fifth Symphony. They know it very well. They know kind of how to play together. But what is the character and the mood of this particular interpretation? So that's what she will have to be demonstrating. That's just a little bit late.
Okay. Good. Zurück zum Anfang.
Nice.
Und nicht vergessen, Christian, das Forzando auf der ganzen Note muss scharf akzentuiert sein.
Okay. German's very nice too.
But it's also... It's like we're hearing it from a very, very great distance. So it's...
So that's an example of what I'm talking about. So he has marked in his part piano, marcato. And the conductor could say, I want this to feel present and visceral. She's saying, I'd like to feel like it's from a very great distance. That's very realistic. That's exactly the kind of language we'd be using in a rehearsal. It's to help create a more uniform approach to the message that the music has. And in this opening section that she conducted, she did a really excellent job. There was only one gesture she gave to the low brass, which was a little bit later than it should have been to elicit the sound that in fact came out. The very opening was, as you might expect from a movie, almost a stylization of dramatic. She goes, ba-da-da-da, like that. In practice, that might be a little OTT. At the same time, hey, why not? You know, audiences love that, and she does look great doing it. So I'm really impressed by the opening of that. Let's see how she continues to rehearse.
Is Harald da? Ah, sehr gut. Harald, I was just wondering if you might quickly rig something up for us.
I'm assuming here a cut from one rehearsal to the next, because in practice, rigging that up would take a minimum of 5 minutes of rehearsal time, probably longer, and that's incredibly valuable. When you're in front of an orchestra of, as it is, 100 people here, these are all absolute experts in their particular field. When you stop them, you have to say something that is really productive, really specific, and really clear, and is going to add value to the whole experience. And that, frankly, above and beyond knowing how to control an orchestra with your hands is the most daunting prospect. Because what do you do if you stop a group of 100 experts in their field and say, I need to give you a tip as to how to do this better? That was not right. Well, I guess so. What would often happen by the time you get to a concert is that the conductor won't conduct the trumpet. But it's valid in the rehearsal, because they're playing on their own. Yeah. Good. I think she conducted that very beautifully. In rehearsal, she's trying to guide the player who's now off stage, who'll be playing using the screen, a video of her. And she conducted it very beautifully. And I have to say that up to now in this excerpt, Kate Blanchett has not only been excellently trained in how to conduct, but she's also obviously put in an enormous amount of work to do it authentically. And all of the impulses, all the gestures really are top-notch. So that's like a little passive aggressive. She said in German, no matter how much you nod with your head, I'm still not hearing the sforzando. Probably going to annoy a few people by putting it like that. You don't need to put it like that. But that's part of her character in this movie. And it's what was so fun about her character. Throughout, she doesn't shy away from being pretty abrupt and brutal with people that she's working with. I think there are ways to do that with an orchestra where you don't have quite as much passive aggression, but hey, why not? It's a movie. Should we look at a different one? Aha! Maestro. What an amazing production, what a fabulous movie, and what an important and beautiful story to tell. Leonard Bernstein is one of the towering geniuses of the 20th century. As to Bradley Cooper's initial body language as a conductor, there's one thing he's doing in a gesture. He gives good what we call downbeats. That's the heavy beat at the beginning of a measure. To God is what they're singing. One, two, three, four. But if you watch it again, what you'll see is that he speeds through the second, third, fourth beats a little bit. Now, you can do this, but the manner in which he is doing it doesn't look quite organic the way a conductor would it. So I could, for example, say one, two, three, four, one, but I keep the gesture a little bit smaller because, in fact, I wouldn't really do it, but if I was going to do it, I'd kind of just keep the gesture small. He's going one, two, three, four. So you see quite a big gesture that is going to catch the eye of a musician. Remember, they're playing the violins and cellos and violas around him, and the woodwind and brass players are 20, 30, 40 feet away from him. So a lot of the connection with the conductor is peripheral. Any gesture you make has meaning, and it can have effect. So you need to be sparing and very conscious of it. So anything that speeds up or slows down that doesn't reflect what the music is doing is a potentially problematic. A conductor like Bernstein would not have done it like that. Well, it's hard to criticize, though, because so much of what he's doing is extraordinary as well. So let's keep going. So they're singing God to God, God to God. Now, what the chorus needs, the choir, is the attack when to sing to of to God, to God. So they need to see the G of God and then the T of to. So Ga to Ga. Those are the important things. If you watch that little excerpt, he's giving quite a lot of other motions, and then the T of the to God, he's giving a little bit late. I will add, he has the real London Symphony Orchestra sitting around him. So everybody who's playing is actually playing, and they're the top, top, top professionals of our industry. I love that. You can just see the passion with which these musicians are playing. It's impossible to play this music basically without going nuts because it's extraordinary. I love that gesture. So Bernstein. This opening up of the body in pure elation, pure joy. And the timing of the chorus worked. They're supposed to sing, no, yum. So you have a second attack before the final notes of the piece, so to speak. He gives that very late in this, and it would have been a bit on the dangerous side if he'd been conducting it in earnest. but let's give him the benefit of the doubt there. And I have to say that the many years of practice that went into this, and also the guidance of one of today's great conductors, Yannick Nissé-Séguin, paid off tremendously in the movie. Because even though there are, without doubt, moments where those of us who are in the industry say, oh, that's not exactly right, the spirit, the attitude, and also the desire and attempt to try and mimic the passion and the joy and the looseness also of Leonard Bernstein as a conductor is extraordinary. They did an extraordinary job with the film, and for those of you who haven't seen it, I can definitely recommend it. Okay, so this one's apparently a surprise. Let's see what's happening here. Fantastic. Oh, this movie. Disney, this is genius, and the whole intent behind this is genius as well. My kids have been watching these extraordinary movies that have been made across the generations with music at their center, and they're so evocative. Music evokes so much in kids. My kids are currently 5 and 2. You know, we think that kids will find this stuff hard. They don't. It evokes all of these images and ideas, and it gets their imaginations just going crazy. And I think we tend to lose that as we get older. We become so rational and staid that we forget the magic and the beauty in these things. And Disney led the way. What I love about this, in the deepest sense, that Mickey is the conductor, not just of the timing, but of the fantasy itself. I think that's a very beautiful image for audiences, but also for conductors themselves to have front of mind. You're not a timekeeper, you're not a metronome. You have the obligation to conjure the magic that is at the heart of all these extraordinary pieces of music. This was really fun looking at these. They all did excellent jobs in different ways. From the 3 or indeed 4 excerpts that I've seen, if I had to pick a standout, I would say that Cate Blanchett in that Mahler 5 was really authentic in her gestures. And marrying that up with the live orchestra really is persuasive. Next up would be Bradley Cooper and the amazing work he did there. I mean, directing, writing, acting, conducting, the list is never ending. And then Mozart in the Jungle, where they just had to create so much content and such, you know, such a short amount of time. He manages to really elicit the atmosphere of the music. So again, chapeau. And I mean, maybe I should put Mickey top. I don't know. Mickey, like, those guys and gals at Disney, they're geniuses, and he did very well. But I'm going to stick with that order. I'm going to stick with it. Cate Blanchett, Bradley Cooper, Mozart in the Jungle, Fantasia.